fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. Yes, I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Jesus said unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. For we know that if your earthly house, this temple, is destroyed, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens, but has now been revealed by the appearing of our Savior, Jesus Christ, who has abolished death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup runs over. Surely, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth be removed. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. All right. Put those hands together.
well, why don't we do this? Why don't we go ahead and greet somebody, hug somebody, shake somebody's hand, and just let them know that this is the day that the Lord has made, and yet we will rejoice and be glad in it. You can greet them. We're starting right at 11 o'clock.
To know Elder Mel was to know a man of integrity, a man blessed with God's gift to make things happen. I mean, we would always say that, make things happen. But you know what else it was to know about Elder Mel? The boy could dress his socks off. Elder Mel was a fashionista.
Thank you. relationship with Lily Courtney, which you prefer, like to call me as C. Griff. Thank you so much for being a true inspiration in my life and also being one of the greatest supporters a man could ever ask for. I also admire your ambition, your passion, your love you have for life, ministry, people, family, and most importantly, you have for God.
He really made things happen in my life by exposing me to some of the better things in life that I had no idea they really existed. It was through Mel A. Pryor that I had an opportunity to travel and to see different things in the world, to go to different other ministries and see different people and meet great men of God.
That was the first time that I met Mel A. Pryor. My mother, she attempted to introduce me to Mel to help guide me down the path of manhood. But Mel was the only individual at the time that took an interest in my well-being. I continue to do it the spirit of excellence by making things happen. Your buddy, Desmond.
You know, I was thinking about the transitioning of our dear beloved Elder Mel A. Pryor, and I knew we were saying, Mel, please don't leave us. Don't go. It'll be all right. Just hang in there. It's not time for you to go yet. It's not time. But then I thought about what was happening on the other side in heaven, where Bishop Marvin C. Pryor and all of God's heavenly angels were cheering him on and shouting, come on, boy, come on, you can make it. You're almost home. You're on your way to God. You're dying. There's no more sin. There's no more tears. Come on. Come on, you're almost here. Because you're here with us now in a place called victory.
Has come, and it is time for us to celebrate the homecoming of Elder Mel A. Pryor. Come on, somebody clap those hands. And give God praise. Come on, we can do a little bit of that. I know that death has a two-edged sting to it. It separates us from our beloveds, but it also brings us together in unity and oneness. As we develop this service today, I'm going to ask that everyone please comply with what has been written. The family has done an excellent job in enduring this time, but we want to just take a few moments, if we could, to stand and applaud this Pryor family. They were built for this. strength that they're showing us. It's phenomenal. And to the BBN family, we salute you as well. You're under great leadership, and it's obvious, quite obvious, that we can make it through our celebration today very timely. Remain standing. We're going to have an invocation by Apostle Vernus Johnson. And immediately following him, we will have our New and our Old Testament scripture reading. There will be worship throughout this entire experience. Why don't you just look at somebody and say, we came to worship the Lord today. On behalf of our brother, Elder Mel A. Pryor. Clap those hands one more time. Apostle Johnson's going to come, and after that, we will have our scripture reading. Let's pray. Father, in all things and in every circumstance, we give you praise because you remain worthy of our glory, our honor, and all praise. God of comfort and strength, the healer of our broken hearts, the mender of our torn pieces, we come to you today. Especially in times like this, we need to pull on the strength that you promised us. You said you would never leave us. To our brokenness, you can speak to our pain. So we pray that you speak in this house like you spoke to the winds and waves that obeyed your voice. Speak like you spoke to Lazarus' dead body and raised him again. Speak like you spoke to creation. You commanded and it stood fast. You declared it and it came to pass. So Father, we pray you speak through every song, through every memory, through every tribute. Speak to us and lift our heads as we give you praise and give you glory. We enter your gates with thanksgiving. We come to your court with praise. We are thankful unto you, and we bless your holy name. For you are good. Your mercy is everlasting. Your truth endures through all generations. And so we clap our hands. We lift our voices, and we give your name the glory. We give your name the praise. For you alone are worthy. We lift you up. We magnify you. We glorify you. There's none like you. You stand alone in who you are. You stand alone in what you've done. We cry, Hosanna. Blessed be the rock of our salvation. He that was and is to come. So bless us today as we pour our hearts before you, as we lean on you, as we trust you to get us through these tough times, and we trust you to make a way where there is no way, to lift our heads and to dry our tears. Father, when you've done these things for us, in the days to come, we won't forget that it was you and you alone that's given us the victory. We lift this family before you, especially today, to be their comfort and be their strength. This church family, this church family at large. We pray all these things in the mighty and precious name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen and amen.
Shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord shall preserve you from all evil. He shall preserve your soul. The Lord shall preserve your going out and your coming in from the time forth and even forever, evermore. Bless the Lord.
Brethren, concerning those who have fallen asleep, lest you sorrow as others who have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep in Jesus. For those who say to you, by the word of this revelation, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will by no means precede those who are asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, and the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then those who are alive and remain will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And thus we shall always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words.
Father God, in the name of Jesus, I ask that you move mightily in this service today. Lord, I surrender every part of this service to you. Father God, we thank you for Mel. We thank you, Lord God, for his service, Lord God. We thank you for his spirit of being here and working diligently in victorious believers, Father God. We thank you, Lord God, for the whole spiritual family, Lord God, of the Priors and Trices coming together this afternoon. So, Father God, right now, in the name of Jesus, I pray your strength come into this room right now and strengthen your body, strengthen your family as we praise you, as we lift you, as we magnify you for being God and being God Almighty. Lord God, we surrender absolutely every part of this service to you. Yeah. Everything that will be said, everything that will be done, yeah, let it be done in a decency and in order, Father God. I pray for Mother Trice right now in the name of Jesus.
Yes.
Strengthen her, Lord God.
Yes.
Strengthen the siblings in the name,
yes,
of Jesus. Woo. I pray right now. I love you, Lord God.
Yes.
You're so mighty.
Yes.
I feel your presence in this room. So, Father God, we give it all up to you. So I want you to bless this service, Lord God, from the start to the finish, from the beginning to the end, from the pulpit to the door, from the ceiling to the floor, fill this room and move mightily.
Oh, yes.
And we give you praise.
Yes.
We give you honor.
Yes.
We give you glory.
Yes.
And if you love the Lord, put those hands together and bless God in this house. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Before you take your seat, we're going to follow up some protocol. And
We're going to ask that you would hold your applause until these names have been called. Our bishop, the Bishop Samuel Duncan, who is the prelate of the Third Ecclesiastical Jurisdiction, is present with us today. Bishop Vincent Matthews, International President of the Missions Department of the Churches of God in Christ. Bishop Marvin L. Winans of the Perfecting Faith Ministries in Detroit, Michigan. National Trustee Superintendent Darren Burns. Bishop Herbert J. Williams. Bishop Daryl Hines. Bishop Zachary Williams. And we have a whole host of men and women of God who are here today that if I started calling your names, we'd be in trouble. I've got the toughest job in the place today. So let's applaud them right now and thank God for them being with us. We will hear from them in their honorable respective places. We wanted to address this floor and make sure that everyone knows that we are excited about supporting this family, and we are just pleased that so many men and women of God traveled from so many different places to be here today to celebrate the homegoing of our brother, our beloved Elder Mel A. Pryor. The music ministry is going to go forth at this time, and it's about to turn into church. I know it's hard for the family at this point, but to be absent from the body, as Pastor just said, is to be present with the Lord. So we celebrate the fact that the transition is complete, and Elder Mel is rejoicing in the presence of the Lord right now. Our choir is going to come, and then we'll have expressions. And I'm going to ask that you please comply with the two-minute rule, because they used to say they'll pull your coattail. I think we've got technology now where they'll just cut the microphone if we have to. We're going to honor, of course, Evangelist Pryor, as well as Pastor Christopher and Lady Kenyatta in this house. And we're going to do whatever we need to do to stay within our time frame and be respectful of this family in today's occasion, because it is a celebration. Look at somebody and say, it's a celebration of life. Let's say amen. Thank you.
Hallelujah. And all the good times and all
I said, we're going to recognize as many as possible, but we do have some words that will be shared in remembrance. Is Pastor Alex Husky here? We were attempting to identify everyone prior to the service started. Come on up, Pastor, if you can. After we hear from Pastor Alex Husky, all the way from New Bethany Church of God in Christ in Marin, Illinois, in this order, we're going to hear from Sister Sherry Hodges, who's the Executive Secretary here at VBM. We're going to hear from Deacon Ellis Burns, excuse me, we'll hear from Evangelist Barbara Littles. They're representing each of these areas. Pastor of the Prayer Garden Church of God in Christ. We're going to try to expedite so that we can move forward. Some of our bishops will have to leave and catch flights, but aren't you glad that they took the time today to be with us today? And all of our administrative assistants and all of our pastors, why don't we do this? Can we have all of the clergy to stand at this time, all of our men and our women of God who serve in clergy as pastors and evangelists and apostles and prophets and teachers. This speaks volumes to the life of Elder Mel A. Pryor and what has been put in him to honor. With those remarks coming from those persons, respectively.
God bless you, church. To my segregate family, the Pryor family, to Presidium and all of Victorious Believers family. It's a little bit difficult to stand here today on the humanistic side, but on the side of me that understands the relationship that we all have with the Lord. It's easy to stand in the gap, Mother. Many don't know this, but Mel and I were best friends for a long time growing up. And I can recall that we made a deal with each other. And I'm ashamed to say, in some sense, I broke the deal. The deal that we had was that when we were to get married, he was supposed to be my best man. And I was supposed to be his best man. I ran away and got married. And he didn't get to be my best man. And the next time we talked, he told me about that. And if you understand where I'm going with this, I enjoyed so much time with the Pryor family. And I can remember the times, and I know time is short, and I'm not going to try to preach, just tell you a story and comfort the family. But I can remember going to their house a lot of times, and Bishop Pryor liked his ice cream. And he would love to give you lessons in life. Sometimes they were about using sports analogies, and sometimes they were just about finance. And what Mother and Bishop Pryor did not know that Mel and I would try to learn those lessons, and then we would go back and we would teach them to each other all over again. But I figured out something that happened in life. Not only did Mel practice those lessons, but he learned them. And as he learned those lessons, he dedicated himself to the service of the Lord. So while we are in this place today, celebrating this life and the legacy, we ought to do so with thanksgiving in our heart. Because this isn't the end of Mel A. Pryor's story. It's just the beginning of the chapter in glory. He's been saved from the penalties of sin. He's been saved from the power of sin. He's been saved from the presence of sin. But now he rejoices in the presence of the Lord. We ought to rejoice with him. We ought to worship with him. We ought to praise with him. Because that would make his soul happy. Mother, be comforted. Derek, be comforted. Brother Chris, Pastor Chris, be comforted. Sister Vonda, be comforted. And know that the glory of the Lord yet is with you, yet shall sustain you, and yet shall keep you. Amen.
The staff of Victorious Believers Ministries would like the family to know that we love you and we are here for you. We're here to hold you up. First of all, we like to say that Elder Mel was a man of excellence. And I don't say the word excellent lightly. He was of excellence. And when I say he held the staff together, he held us together. We were a team. We come as a team, not as individual. He made us love each other, and he pulled out the best in each one of us. I mean, things that we thought we couldn't do, some kind of way, he found it in us to do it. He was a joyful and fun person. He made the office fun. We would come in every day, and in the wintertime, I would text Barb and say, Barb, the Eskimo is coming in. Because Elder Mel couldn't stand the coldness. He couldn't take being cold at all. So when he would walk in, he would have all these clothes on. Good, all. And I said, here come the Eskimo. But we loved Elder Mel. He had a niche for editing. He was perfect. Anything that came through the church had to stop by the chief administrator, and you might get it back 20 times, but when it go out, it's gonna be right. And if you have one question to ask Elder Mel, you had to enter his office at your own risk. Because if you have one question, you might get the right answer, but you might walk out of his office in another hour. We loved Elder Mel dearly. He was so special to us. He was a special friend to me. But as the staff, we loved him dearly. He did special things for us. He made us feel like a family. And when I say he pulled out things in us, things when we would say that we couldn't do it, he said, yes, you can. Yes, you can. Just make it happen. Just make it happen. Go, 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 go. Just make it happen. And we loved him for that. We had so many, like, all of a sudden parties. We would just party. I would say, Elder Mel, can we up our Christmas party? Can we take it to another level? Because we would have a Christmas party, and we would just, you know, have snacks, kind of sit around. And so one year I said, Elder Mel, can we take it to another level? Just do what you do. Just go ahead. Just make it happen. So we took it to another level. I mean, we had tables all in the hallway of the covered cloth tablecloths. I mean, we had set up full course meal for our Christmas dinner. And we would sit, all the whole staff would be sitting waiting on Elder Mel to come out. He'd be in the office. And where's Elder Mel? What's that? So I go knock on his door. I said, Elder Mel, everybody is waiting on you. We need to get started. What were we waiting on? For him to come out ringing the bell with his Santa Claus hat on. So that's, he wanted to make his big grand entrance. But even on that, to make a long story short, even with that, every end of the year, every Christmas, I never will forget, every end of the year, he imparted something in each one of us. He would thank us for working for that entire year. Bishop Pryor started it. He would thank us for working that entire year. He said, because it's not easy working for the church. And Elder Mel would go to each one of us. He would tell Deacon Ellis what an excellent job he's doing, keeping this church together, you know. And Deacon Ellis would, you know, go up. That made him feel good. But the next year, Deacon Ellis was going to do it again. He knew what he was doing. And then he would just compliment Sister Barb. Can't nobody talk to these people like Sister Barb. They might call getting Sister Barb told, get smart with Sister Barb, but Sister Barb be so sweet. and she'll keep them on the phone. And the other man will say, go tell her, okay, she can get off now, that's enough. They should be fine now. So go tell her, get off. But Barb is the most patient person he was. And then Sister Erina came in loving us and ministering to us. And she's been here for 2 years, and she just fell right in place with the staff. And he loved every one of us, but he poured into us, and he encouraged us. And we thank him for it. And to the prior family, we want you to know that we're here for you and we love you dearly.
Good morning. I stand on behalf of the Victorious Believers Board of Directors. If all the current board of directors could stand, and for anyone who's ever served on the board of directors with Elder Mel, could you also please stand? I'd like to say this morning, to God be the glory for all that he has done. And I want to say to the Pryor family, on behalf of the board of directors, we absolutely love you and we are here for you. I will say this about Elder Mel. Sister Sherry really said a lot, but I'd like to say that I've seen great administrators and good administrators. But I never saw the gift, the spiritual gift of administration and operation until I met Elder Mel. He was not only meticulous about work, we thought we'd finish a matter, and Elder Mel said, but, said, Elder Mel, you should have gone to law school, but, and he could have worked and did work in the corporate arena, but he could have worked at any Fortune 100 company in this world. But he chose to work the kingdom. He chose to work the church. And I would come in the morning. If I came by in the morning, Elder Mel was here. If you come late at night, Elder Mel was here. He was here to make sure that things got done. On Wednesdays, it was a long day, Elder Mel would be here. And so, as Sherry said, everything that went out in excellence, because he truly was a man of excellence. He was funny, he would make you laugh, but he was serious about taking care of business. And so he led us very well. He led the board very well. He served Bishop Webb very well. He served pastor. He served the church. And even with his gift of administration, he was also always concerned about the people of God. He was concerned about the members. He was concerned about the staff. And he would make sure that in all our doing business, that we never forgot the people.
Hallelujah! Hallelujah! As a matter of fact, I drove him home the last day that he was alive, and we were there for him. And so I just cherish all of those memories and how he trusted us to be able to do the things that needed to be done in the ministry. One thing about Elder Mel, as many have already said, he was very meticulous about everything that he did. Not only did he say make things happen, he showed you how to make things happen. He wasn't just a leader who told you to get out there and do things, but he showed you step by step how to do things. And because of that, we have a strong men's ministry here at the church. Just some of the things that he organized for us to do, we always had quarterly men's breakfast where we brought all of the men together and invited men to come in. We always have our annual men's weekend. And if you know anything about our men's weekend, Elder Mel brought some of the biggest names in here. Bishop Marvin Winans, Bishop Daryl Hines, Pastor Donnie McClurkin, and so many more. He loved to bring people in because he wanted to exemplify the excellence that this ministry exemplified. And so we just praise and thank God for him. Not only did we have our quarterly men's breakfast, we had a mentor program called the Voice of Victorious Men's Ministry that he created. And so we have so many things that we do because he organized it. He laid the foundation for everything that we do now. I know that he was in Philadelphia. He came from Philadelphia, and many of the things that he learned in the ministry there, he brought those things to this ministry. He served for 16 years,
as the men's director here at Victorious Believers Ministries. And one of the things that one of the things about Elder Mel that some people may not know, he was a member of the executive board of the men's department for the Church of God in Christ. And our theme was Proverbs 27 and 17. Iron sharpens iron, so a man sharpens the countenance of his friend. And so Elder Mel, he came up with that scripture for the ministry, and the Church of God in Christ took on that same scripture for their men's department. And so we just thank and praise God for Elder Mel. I love them dearly. The men loved them dearly. He had a passion for men. One of the things he always told us, every man that enters the doors of this church, make sure we have contact with them. Make sure that we let them know that we love them and that we are glad that they have made it to this ministry to be a part of the service. We just thank and praise God on tonight. Pride family, we love you. We're going to continue to do what we've been doing. We've been trained and we've been taught by the best. And so, Pastor Chris, we're here for you. We're going to continue to go forth in ministry. Elder Mel's legacy lives in us. He's an awesome man of God. The things he taught us, we're going to continue to teach other people, and the ministry shall go forth. God bless you.
To the Reef family, clergy, friends, June 8th, 1953, on this day, before there were weather sirens, one of the most deadly storms in U.S. history struck the city of Flint, the community of Beecher. Destruction was unbelievable. High school was flattened. The North Flint drive-in was a total loss. Homes and businesses fell before the twisting blast. Hundreds of casualties were reported at the drive-in theater. Injured residents at Hurley Hospital said the storm struck without warning. Families were in their homes listening to the radio, reading papers, watching television, or eating dinner when the whirlwind struck. An older lady who witnessed that tornado described it like this. She said, just before it hit, it sucked all of the oxygen out of the atmosphere. There's some people, when they walk into a room or an arena, they suck all the oxygen out. Mel Pryor was just the opposite. We worked together for General Motors in the mirror room, and when the morale was at an all-time low, a young man named Melvin Pryor was hired by Buick of General Motors. And when he walked into the mirror room, it was just something about his persona that flipped the switch. Before there was a what's up, there was God in the morning, then it was good morning, and it was just morning, Melvin created the what's up. A thermometer tells you the temperature in the room. A thermostat regulates the temperature. Like a thermometer, some people simply reflect the temperature, the feel of an environment, and others, like a thermostat, set the temperature in the room. Mel Pryor set the temperature in the room.
As you can see, there's nothing but good things to say about this man of God. Why don't you just look at somebody and say, make things happen. That's a theme that Elder Mel picked up in college, where I originally met him many years ago, before I knew I would serve under his dad, the late Bishop Martin C. Pryor. His uncle, Pastor Larry Trice Sr., was my pastor, and I served under him as well. But while in college, my wife and I got to meet Mel both individually. She had math class with him, and I stayed as far away from math as possible. And she knew Mel, and he invited her to various revivals. In fact, she was at the, which wedding anniversary was that? The 25th wedding anniversary of Bishop and Lady Pryor, because Mel invited her. Now, I ended up marrying this lovely lady, but Mel continued to be our great, great friend. And I remember him in such a very positive way at Michigan State University. Are there any Spartans in the room? Oh, come on. For Elder Mel, where are the Spartans at? Well, we're going to take a few moments and we're going to go up the road to Ann Arbor and we're going to recognize the supervisor of the women's department of the 3rd Ecclesiastical Jurisdiction. And that's none other than Mother Early Peppers. Let's say amen to her as she comes. Immediately following Mother Peppers, we're going to have a solo selection by Pastor Larry Trice Jr., my brother and friend, pastor of the Tabernacle of David Church in Lansing, Michigan.
Bless you, choir family, the bishop, my bishop, all of my clergy there. I mean, it's a lot of women in this place. Hey, 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 hey! Can I hear somebody say amen? I got 2 minutes with all of these women. You in the Church of God Christ know what I'm talking about. We're so pleased it's a party to be here today. And I was thinking just on yesterday, Mother Pryor lost, well, she knows where he is, not lost. So Mel went to home to be with the Lord. But he has Derek, Pastor Chris, Vonda, and siblings. Oh, and they grew up together with him. And I sent Pastor Chris a text yesterday and said, remember the good, the bad, and the ugly. He's your brother. But God will see you through, too. Yeah, your mom is crying. I'd be crying if it was Rod, my son over there, stand up, Rod. Let him see you. He grew up with Mel. Yeah. But the siblings are yet here. We say to you, we love you dearly, and we're praying for you. Only the Lord can get you through where you gotta go. That love Mother Pryor and the whole family. We got a lot of people like Mother Winan and call some names over there that love the Pryor family that are here today visiting with the Pryor, not just preachers, but the bishop's wife. Just stand up, Dorothy. Stand up, Diane Bogan. Stand up, Mother Walton. Adam, Regina Edwards. Stand up, Mother. Hallelujah. All these preaching women in the churches of God in Christ. And this one standing right here is Bishop James L. Whitehead's wife. In Michigan, the supervisors and the bishop's wife, we meet 3 or 4 times a year. So the bishop's wife of Michigan and whoever is in charge today, just let me do this. Okay, I only need a minute or so. But Mother Whitehead is here today. She has a resolution. She's not going to read it, but she has a presentation for Mother Pryor, which was and is still, once you're a bishop's wife, just because he went on to be with the Lord, it doesn't change your title. You're still a bishop's wife. Come on, give me a hand. Clap on that. Because a lot of people think that she's not a bishop's wife. Oh, I know what I'm talking about. I know what I'm talking about. I know. Yes, yes. Women do matter. They're talking about Black Lives Matter. Women matter. A hand, women. Mother Walter, won't you come? Mother Mary Jane Walter will come. Have a.
We love you to this great family, the Pryor family. We give honor to the deceased, honorable Bishop Marvin Pryor. And to this family, I'm here representing Mother Willie Mae River, excuse me, Mother Willie Mae Shear, who is the international president of the Bishop's Wives, as well as the Council of Michigan and Ontario Bishop's Wives. We have a resolution for you and a card of love. We would not miss, dare not miss, to be here with you today. We're praying for the family.
Thank you. Mother Mary Jane Walton, everybody in the Church of God in Christ knows Mother Mary Jane.
I have the supervisors to stand. Mother Pryor, you knew Mel was my number 4 son. He was so special to me. Every time he saw me, Pastor Chris, he would raise up number 4 so I wouldn't forget. So I told him one day, I said, Mel, I'm not senile. I know you're number 4. And I want to thank the Lord. He never, never forgot me on Mother's Day. He was so kind to me. Mother Pryor, we are here because we love you special. I'm going to ask the supervisors to please stand there. Stanley, we love you. God bless you. Also, another supervisor from out of town called me late last night, Mother Patricia Lofton. She said, you would have been here that last year. She said, but Mother Walton, you coming this year because Mother Pryor couldn't have. Thank you for that appointment, Mother Pryor. May God bless you. Coach and my assistant, Mother Emma, would you come and present this to Mother Pryor? We love you so much, and thank you, Mother.
Amen, amen. All of these women in this area, just stand up. All you women right there, real quick, stand up. I know you're over 50, some of you. Stand up real quick. These are, we call them the missionaries and the pastor's wives and all of the ladies in the Church of God in Christ and other reformations that come today to tell you they love you, Pryor family.
Come on, let's bless the Lord for all the ladies of the church. All of the ladies. There's nothing like a mother's love except that of a church mother's love. And we thank God for them. Thank you so much for the time to recognize. You know that the love is here. Family was important to Elder Mel. Very, very important. In fact, if you got too close, you'd become part of the family. And I had the privilege of being very, very close and adopted into both the Pryor as well as the Trice family. Pastor Larry Trice Jr. is going to come and he's going to render a solo selection. And he is going to minister on behalf of the family. And then we'll have some family remarks and tributes. We would like for the expressions from our bishops to be held very special. We're going to be moving Bishop Hines up to the first speaker after Pastor Larry Trice comes. Because Bishop Hines has to fly out and catch a plane really, really quickly. But we thank God for these men and women of God being with us. Let's say amen to Pastor Larry as he comes.
God bless you, family. I love Mel. When we were taught, when they told you to get up and do something, do what they told you to get up and sit down. And Ruth and Mom told us that we might not ever understand God and what happened, but everything he did was right. So that's the confidence that we have, that he cannot make a mistake. And he cannot mess up. I was asked to sing. So I said, well, I try to find me a little song to sing. And Ruth and Christopher said, no, sing this song right here. And I said, well, I don't know that song. And they said, well, now you can't tell us, you know, whatever you could do, and then all at once, do what you want to do. I was like, I thought we was grieving. I thought we was all grieving. Few seconds. Our prayers have all been answered, finally arrived. The healing that has been delayed has now been realized. See, no one's in a hurry. There's no schedule to keep. All enjoying Jesus, sitting at his feet. Yeah. If you could see me now, walking streaks of gold. If you could see me now, I'm standing tall and whole. You could see. You can see me now, yeah. You know the pains he raised. Yeah. You wouldn't want me ever leave this place. You could only see me now.
Temporary trial, yeah. All worked out for my good. Just know it gave God glory, though we misunderstood. And yes, you have some. to what Jesus has in store for us. No language can share. If you could see me now, I'm walking streets of gold.
Christian Faith Fellowship Church in Milwaukee, but he is also a newly elected general board member of the Church of God in Christ, and I am just so godly proud to be in his midst. Would like for you to just clap your hands, give God praise for Bishop Darrell Hines as he comes. He then will be followed by Bishop-elect Marvin L. Winans of the Perfecting Fellowship International Church. Then Bishop Vincent Matthews, President of the International Missions Department. Let's say amen to Bishop Hines.
Being here is such a wonderful joy. And I honor God through Jesus Christ, who the scriptures have declared that God has caused him to become sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. Evangelist Pryor, Pastor Chris, and to the entire Pryor family, I just wanted to come and let you know that share in your loss, and I appreciate your son. Bishop Patterson first asked me to share as the chairman of the Conference for Men's Ministry for the Church of God in Christ. I wasn't real familiar with the personalities in the church, didn't quite know who to go and ask to help me. Now, he gave me one suggestion of one person. As a matter of fact, when we first went to be, not when we went to the celebration to be appointed, I went to the door and said, I'm the chairman of the men's department. We ain't got no men's department to sit me around another door. So I had no love in the first beginning. But Mel made his way to me. And I had seen him in some other areas in the church. I would share with him. Saw him in the Azusa Conference a few times. And he said, listen, I can help you with the men's ministry. And I'm so happy that I allowed him to help me. Amen. As one of the first members of our board, board members of the men's ministry, to try to get it off the ground. And one thing I loved about him, he was always helpful, but he never forced his help. He would wait until after we had made full discussions and had no solutions, and he would make suggestions, and they would always come out to be fine. So I just came to let you all know I love you, and I love him. Our loved ones, when they leave, of course, many of us, and I'm going to my seat, we think that they didn't leave us a lot of money, or they didn't leave a lot for us to inherit financially, that they didn't leave us wealth. But if know anything about people, they always leave us with something of value. Yeah. First of all, they leave us with memories.
Yeah.
Memories cannot be replaced, nor can they be taken away
That's
from
right.
you. Secondly, they leave their influence. Whatever impression or influence that they had on your life while they were living, it remains with you Amen. When they go into glory. And then last but not least, they leave us with hope.
Yeah. Yes.
For the Bible says, for we're so passed about with so great a cloud of witness, and they become a part of the witnessing team that's in heaven now, cheering us on, that we will see them one day. So my prayers are with you. Sorry I have to leave before the service is over, but I wanted to be here. God bless you, Mother Pryor. I love you. Chris, I love you. And to the other family members, God bless you. I love you. Of course, honor Bishop Duncan, Bishop Williams, honor Bishop Matthew and Bishop Winans. God bless you all. Well, God is worthy to be praised. How many know he's worthy to be praised? I give honor to Bishop Duncan, Bishop Hines, Bishop Williams, and to our Bishop over the Missions Department, to Mother Peppers, to all of the mothers. I praise God, and my prayers are with you, Mother Pryor. You know, everywhere I saw you, I saw Mel. Yeah, he was everywhere, and I understand that because since my father passed, my mother has sort of been a consistent date. I'm happy to have Mother Winans here today. And I know Mel was with you all the time, and I know if something was to happen to me, my mother would be just rolling in the flow. She didn't, even though she had six other sons, she would really be disturbed if something was to happen to me. So I'll pray for her. And to Pastor Chris, I understand, and because there's never a day that goes by that I don't think about my brother Ronald. And I mean, it's tough, but you just learn. I mean, I just left South Africa yesterday. And there are things that happened along the way, and I said, Lord, if Ronald was here, and Ronald would be laughing at this. And this goes on all the time, constantly. So as Bishop Hines said, the memories will be there. No sense in fighting them. But we praise God. I've been a part of this Trice family since I was in my early 20s, as the late Larry Trice would have me preach revival when I was 21, 22 years old at the little church. And so I see Mother Trice and Mother Trice. She was in Jackson and the other church. I just praise God for the memories that we have together and that they never have to end. So our prayers are with you. I'm not going to prolong the service. And God bless you.
Greetings. Entire family. I'm probably not the person to speak because I'm a family member, but I do have something to share about my brother Mel. Think that on the program there's a name missing for him. His middle name should be Barnabas. Barnabas should be there because he's a son of encouragement. And he's won many championships as kind of a point guard, passing the ball to so many people and assisting so many people. I know that because there was a time in the early 90s, my bishop sent me to a meeting, Bishop C.L. Anderson Jr. sent me to a meeting of a gathering of Michigan jurisdictions. I was the public relations director, and I was at this meeting, and Elder Mel was there also. And we by far were the youngest guys at the meeting, and we were joined by all those at the meeting, kind of confused as to why we were there. We waited an hour before the meeting started. We just talked and talked and talked, hence the other name you all gave him, the radio. And we talked about so much and went so far, and then we got our assignments for why we were there to represent our jurisdictions. But then before we left, after this conversation, he said, at the AIM convention in a couple of weeks, I have a workshop that I do, the O.T. Massey Institute, which is in Scholastic Motivation, and I want you to speak at that workshop. Blew me away. I had never done anything outside of really my jurisdiction. I've always gone to AIM, but never spoke or never even expected that. But he said, I want you to speak at that. You'll have about 30 minutes. I went home nervous, and I wrote an outline that became actually the outline for a book that I wrote later. I was that serious to me. And I get there, and I take my 30 minutes. It was a blessing. And Chris speaks, and his wife, Kenyatta, speaks. And I was like, this guy's a real baller, Chris. This guy can go. And from that, I was invited by him the next day to speak. If you remember, the next day, the following day, I spoke 4 days, 2 hours a day, and then I was speaking everywhere in the national convention every year since then. It was him that threw that alley-oop to me and gave me the opportunity to serve in the National Church of God in Christ. I've thanked him many times, and he just said, don't worry about that. And then he invited me here be here and become part of this family and have a father like Bishop Pryor looked out for me all the years we lived in South Africa and all the years I've been away from Michigan. And serving at one of those quarterly men's breakfasts is when I got my prophetic word that I would move to South Africa because I wasn't going until it was a quarterly men's breakfast here. And it was here that I talk about alley-oops that we won a championship playing football right out here. Yeah. I had to mention that. Yeah, on the men's weekend. I want to say that there are some people in our lives that you don't know all they do because they're so busy setting other people up and making sure other people can, they're selfless. And this man of God is selfless. And so I say to you, my mama, my fathers, my mothers, my brothers and my sisters, as we celebrate this life, I brag, when I was living in South Africa, I brag, people in South Africa think that Detroit and Michigan is the promised land. Yeah, would you believe it that most people in Johannesburg and the township Tembisa, they're all wearing Lions gear. They believe they're a championship team. Don't tell them anything else. They're praying for the Lions. I don't know what's going on. True story. Yeah. But when I brag, I tell saints that I disciple about men like Mel, about men like Chris, about the people that I left home, about the strongest state in the Church of God in Christ, the state of Michigan, and where I was raised. And so as I come to this celebration of life, I celebrate my brother who has, rightfully so, been promoted before us. Because Lord knows I need some more time to measure up to where he is. So we celebrate Barnabas. God bless you.
Wonderful tributes, and they are quite befitting. Wouldn't you agree?
Yeah.
Amen. I've been instructed we're going to take a little bit of a deviation in the program, and we're going to bring back Bishop Marvin Winans to come and do a selection. What do you think? Now, this platform is filled with Stellars and Grammys and wonderful men of God, but we're going to ask that he would come just before the family's tributes. We know that Brother Derek and Alexis, as well as Lauren, is going to come, and then Missionary Vonda will be coming, Pastor Chris Carrington Chandler, they'll be coming as well. But just before they do, we would love to hear from Bishop Marvin L. Winans, perfecting Fellowship International.
Praise the Lord. As I journey to this land, singing as I go, pawning souls to Calvary, to that crimson flow. Many arrows pierce my soul from without within, but my Savior leads me on. You say, oh, I want to see him. Look upon his face and sing forever of his saving grace. Oh, the streets of glory. Hey, let me lift my voice. Cares I pass, I'm home and ask ever to rejoice. Y'all gonna sing with me?
Yeah.
Oh, I wanna see him look upon his face. That'll save me forever.
God when we say yes. Come on, clap those hands. Clap those hands. The family is going to come at this time, and we still have yet to hear the preached word from Bishop Samuel Duncan, and we're going to ask that they would come at this time, and Brother Derek is going to come, and Pastor Chris, along with those who are representing the family. Mother, you're doing all right? Come on, somebody say, God bless Mother Pryor. Amen. This entire family. Do it once more. Let's strengthen them with an applause. Thank you, Bishop Winans, for that. The family is going to come, and then our music ministry is going to come, and we're just going to continue to move forward. Why don't you reach over, hug somebody, and say, we're getting through it? Amen. And we're almost there. These are the siblings of this wonderful man of God. Let's applaud them as they come.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank everyone for coming over to the house. It was just wonderful. I thank you for all your kindness. This is very hard for me. Been reminiscing on my brother going all the way back to childhood years, and we would always play church in the basement. And every now and then we would get into it because I wanted to preach and Mel wanted to preach. We didn't have a band, so we made all our noise with our mouth and stuff like that, with the beatbox and all that, but we would. Mel was shout the most. He just had it in him. He just didn't say much. But next thing you know, he's breaking out in the dance and stuff. But he, I love my brother so much. So proud of him. Going to state, everything he did with excellent. I was able to take him see his doctors and stuff, and we would, me and my brother, we would take him to see his doctors, and he always had something to say. He always had to have the last word. Doctor would give us, you know, he would tell us what we would have to do, and we'd get up, we'd be ready to go. He'd turn around, he had a few more questions, and be like, no, stop. We let him go on and see what he had to say. We were on the phone talking to a doctor or something. The doctor would be talking and he's talking. I was like, why y'all gotta stop talking? I just give me a break. That's just the way he was. He wanted to make sure everything, make sure the doctors talk to each other. They talking. We don't roll at us, everything. It's great. It's fine. We were so excited over the news that he was going to get his hearing back. And we're working on his vision, and we were just really, really excited about that. And really, he was up in spirit. We were just all so excited, and it was just hard. It was just everything was so positive. And my whole year, I claimed that back December 2017 was going to be a great year for me because of my daughter. She's graduating from college at the end of this month, and she was going to get married. This was going to be a blessed year. Just hurt so much. We've always been a close family because that's the way we were raised. And it's just, I know I'm not the first to lose a brother. I understand that, but we all need your prayers. I'm going to turn this over. I don't want to.
So I'm Alexis. I got to spend 22 years with my uncle, and I feel extremely blessed to have been able to do that. We have so many memories. People have talked about how adventurous he was. I remember on our family cruise, we went parasailing, and And we came back and we told Nana, she was like, y'all got up in that sky? And you know, he was always the one to do that with me. He was always the one to get us in trouble at home. Nana would tell us to quit running, and it was always him that started it every single time. Or if we were loud, it was always him. And he would just sit there like he didn't do anything. So I'm really going to miss those. He also loved taking pictures. Everyone knows that. At our recent engagement party, we had a professional photographer, and he gave the photographer his phone because he wanted his own pictures. And we've paid money, but that was just him. And so the thing that I'm gonna miss the most is our big hugs. Every time I saw him, I knew that I had to give him a big hug. In my cards, he wrote, now get over here and give me my big hug. And I'm really gonna miss, you know, giving him his big hugs.
He always showed me that with a disability or pain, you could always make things fun. I learned from him not to do certain things, from the car rides with Nana sticking her heads out the windows, or with him taking me to McDonald's just to get that one Happy Meal. And he was an amazing and loving person, and most importantly, a day maker. I believed he was the next person holding all of our family together after my grandpa passed, so. He was the one to write 2K16 or 17 and to leave the gold chocolate wrap bar, Michigan State. Even though I didn't like chocolate, felt different coming from him. So he will be extremely missed from us, from our weddings and graduations. So I love him so.
Bishop Winans, but I just want to say this, all the glory, the honor, the praises all day, they belong to God. They belong to God. They belong to God. Mama, all the glory, the honor, the praise. I said that because after my husband informed me that Mel had passed, I cried and I cried, and then I went to the room and I laid on the bed, and that song came to my spirit. All the glory, all the honor, all the praises, all day, they belong to God. Now, I didn't sing that to impress you. I didn't even really necessarily sing it to encourage my family, because we are encouraged. I sing it because I want the devil to know that all the glory, the honor, all the praises, every day, all day, belongs to God. So help me say, they belong. Just so admonished and so amazed. You came to church, Sister Massey. God bless you. And I said to them at the end of the service, I said, you know, where else would I be? Where else would I be? I said, I love my brother. Actually, one Sunday, a young lady had testified that she had cancer, and how she was, they were really, it was really serious, cancer of the throat. And when she got, after she finished, I began to dance, because Mel was on our prayer list, him and my mother. And I began to dance, and I called Mom. I said, Mom, we danced for you and Mel this morning. I mean, we danced. So when I got the news and they kept saying, it's so good to see you at church, I said to them, I still believe God is a healer. My faith is stronger than ever. I said, I haven't given up on God. God can heal cancer. necessarily to feel sorry for the Pryor family. Yes, but I said, I danced last night. I was rejoicing because it was a celebration of life. And I said, I have many days that I'm going to cry. I'm gonna have many days that I'm going to hurt. But one thing I can say, Mel knew God. Mel knew God, I tell you. Now let me move forward. Now let me tell you about my experience with Mel. Mel was not only a talker, he was a talker. He loved to pray. Mel would love to pray. And Mel would come out here on Tuesdays and lay prostrate on that floor at noonday prayer, and he would be in here praying. And I got sick one, I got the flu, seemed like I would get the flu every year. And Mel came over to the house one Sunday after church, and he knocked on my door. I was in the bed, I couldn't sleep, I had a bad fever. And he came into the room, he knocked, and he said, Fonda. You know how he talks, Mel. Fonda. And I said, raised up, and I said, oh, Mel, come in. He said, I just came over to see if you needed something to eat. So I said, no, I'm not hungry. I don't have an appetite. So he said, nothing that you want at all. I said, no, nothing that you can think of. I said, no. He says, well, I'm going to pray for you. And Mel came over and he anointed my head. And Mel began to pray. And Mel began to pray. And Mel prayed. And he 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 prayed. You get the point? And he prayed. And Mel prayed so hard that I thought he would never stop. And I had this fever. So I said, I think I know what I'll do. I'll just act like I fell asleep. So I took my head and I went, like I was asleep. And he dipped out. He said, thank God she's sleeping. So he called me the next day and he said, sis, I came over and I prayed and I thank God because you fell right to sleep. Not only was he a good prayer warrior, I was a good actor. Tell Mel that. And he brings so many memories. He was a leader. Everybody thought Mel was older than I, but I was 2 years older than Mel. And Mel was a great leader. He ran for class president. He was voted most likely to succeed, and he did. And he would slip a note up under my door and said, meet me, we're gonna have a meeting for my campaign. And they would hand up posters, and he had them around the school, vote Mel A. Pryor. And one day he came, he said, I got it all laid out. I have a campaign manager, I have a treasurer, and I have a secretary. He said, and you are the secretary. Oh, wow, Mel, thank you. Now, I'm the oldest. He said, I have a plan. Mel, my mom almost got me suspended from school. I went to class, and he said, I made these cards. I want you to pass them out to your classmate. And they say, vote for Mel A. Pryor. Mel A. Pryor. So I was in class, and as my teacher was teaching, I took the little card and was slipping them to the classmate. And my dad was a high school principal at that time. And my teacher stopped and said, excuse me, Miss Pryor, what are you doing? I said, I'm passing out cards for my brother. He's running for class president. And he said, you know the rules. We don't do that during class. So I told Mel. Mel said, how did it go, sis? I said, Mel, you almost got me suspended from school. I said, I was passing them out, and my teacher got so upset. And Mel didn't say, oh, I'm sorry, sis. He said, we've got to think of a better scheme of how to get those cards out. Okay, as he was saying. God, oh, my Lord. Two last stories. You know, my dad was a wonderful, patient man. It took a lot to get my dad angry, a lot. My dad didn't get work involvement. So my dad was on the board where he would go with other bishops around the country and teach church leadership. and he had his papers that he was trying to get ready. And he said, Mel, I need to get those out. I need you to get them over. You're a little late. Come on and get them. I got to get them out. I got to give them to Sherry so she can get them run off. So Mel said, yes, Dad, I hear you. I understand. So Dad is waiting and waiting. And he said to me in his office, he said, where is Mel? I need those papers. Where are those papers? Mel, he calls Mel and he said, Mel, get over there. Mel gets to the house and he comes in and Dad said, I need them, okay? I need to put them in my luggage. And he said, Dad, I'm not quite finished. I have some tweaking to do. My dad said, now, just turn them in. Turn them in. He said, sheesh. He was so funny to me. And I tell you, he made me laugh. And he loved stars. He loved me. He'd tell me and Cindy from Bishop Winish Church are good friends. She's the church administrator. And Nene, he was here. And she said, I talked to her, and she gave me ideals. And I stole some of them and brought him here to VPM. And so he was really proud of that. And he said to me, this is my last story. He said, I love Bishop Noel Jones. And Bishop Noel Jones was really just getting big. This was some years ago at this time. And he said, Father, do you want to ride with me to the D-Town? And I said, yeah, man, where are we going? Going to hear Bishop Noel Jones. Such an awesome speaker. I said, yeah, man, I'm going. He said, I talked to him, and I told him I'd fly down there and get there. And I want to thank Brown's Funeral Home for getting my brother here on time. Mel went nowhere on time. He drove 100 miles everywhere we went. He drove, he talked to you, he sang, he got there, and we drove down, and I was laughing. He said, I called him and told him I'm going to be there. And I was like, yeah, well, yeah, Mel, right. You don't know Bishop Noel Jones. Yes, I do. We're good friends. And I teased him, and I laughed, and I laughed. We get to this place. It's jam-packed. Somehow, Mel maneuvered his way. We got to the front. Bishop Noel Jones got up to preach. He got into his message, and I'm jiggling, laughing. He know Noel Jones. And Noel Jones says, you know, he talks real soft. Two da-da-da scripture in the word. And he was talking and he said, and he got to talking and speaking, he looked up and said, my good friend Elder Mel Pryor is sitting out there. I dropped. Mel looked at me and said, oh, good. That was all he wrote. I never argued with Mel ever again. So I'm not gonna just miss Mel, I'm already missing Mel. We were so close, and he loved Mom. Mel, Chris and Derek and I weren't jealous, he really loved my mom. And we know Mom loved all of them, but they was just ride and die buddies, you know? They did things together, they had fun, and I enjoyed it. I was not jealous one bit, because he really loved you, Mom, and I know you're gonna miss him. But one thing I take comfort in, I know that Mel is with the Lord. Yeah. I know he's with the Lord. God bless. I'm sorry, yes. And because of Mel, praise God. This wonderful man right here, he introduced me to John years ago. He brought him to one of the conferences. And he introduced, Mel introduced a lot of people. Yeah. Brother Gino is here, him and his wife from Philadelphia, Stan Gino. And he was just a great person. Everywhere he went, okay, he loved people. And because of that, I'm married to Elder John Massey. All right.
Hear my cry, O Lord, and attend to my prayer. From the ends of the earth will I cry out to thee. My heart is overwhelmed. Lead me to the rock that is higher than I. I want to just thank each of you for being here to share your love with our family, all the great things that Elder Mel has done, and he's just a loving person. To each of these individuals. all of these bishops, pastors, thank you on behalf of myself, my mother, many of you called. It's unbelievable. Bishop Wyden is just getting back from South Africa. Bishop Hines has been traveling all over the country, and he was trying to get different flights to get here. I can't believe that he made it. And so we're appreciative of all those great things that you continue to do and give us encouraging words. You just heard from another comedian. I'm not the one. But I thank God for my brother Mel. In our home growing up, we had to share the same room. There would be late nights that Mel and I would stay up, and he gave this scripture that we always would say to each other, and it's Hebrews 13:1. And it says, let brotherly love continue. And so we reminded of each other in regards to making sure that we continue to love each other. Mel, as my sister has stated, has always appeared to be much older than he is. And so he would just do so many things. In many years, we would go to the AIM conference, and Mom and Dad would allow Mel to take me. I was 12, Mel was 18. But he was so mature. He would rent cars. He just knew what to do. And when the car didn't work the way he wanted to work, we would take it back and get a new car. He just had that ability. He always just knew what to do, what to say. He was always smiling. And he taught me so many things about taking pictures and striking a pose. If you look at any picture of my brother, he's always leaning forward. But he's just a great person. And so we love each other. I thank God for all the things that he has done. I thank God for his ability to be an administrator of this church. I don't know if he was the heart of love. Yes. But he was so particular. He wanted everything to be great. He loved each and every one of us. And I'm grateful of the life of my brother Mel A. Pryor. So many different things. We would travel, Elder Williams, we would travel together and go to AIM, and Mel would take us. And as my sister said, he was always late. And I think that was just his style, just to be late and make that arrival. And so it's a difficult time because he did so many things. He knew so much of the history of the church, being so close to my father, that he would fill me in because I was a youth pastor and he was on the board. And so there were so many things that Mel did behind the scenes. I would ask him questions. Well, what do I do here? How much do I give here? He already had that in his heart, knowing because that was his heart. He was a true giver. And being the giver that he was, I just thank God for him of giving. We would make our rides down to Lansing, to the convocation, or what have you. And the last few years have been very challenging because he could not hear and was losing part of his vision. But the thing that I remembered about my brother is every time that I would walk into the house, he would be calling out Jesus. He would be laying prostrate before the floor, calling out Jesus and thank you, God, for healing me and strengthening me and keeping me. He was praying. He would be here on Fridays as well, laying before us. And so we will miss him. I thank God for him. The last thing that he said to me was, bro, I love you. Thank you for all that you're doing. I'm here to challenge you today. I mean this. We got to love our family. We got to let stupid, silly stuff quit dividing us. Do you hear me today? Stuff that don't make no kind of sense. We got to let it go. And so when we talk about love, love is an action word. Don't tell me you love me and then you're not around. And so Mel was a loving person. And so if there's anything that I share all the time with Victorious Believers Ministries, I want to be known as a loving church. No matter how much money you have, no matter what your background is, I want you to know that we love you and we care for you. That was the heart that my brother had, that we would love each other, that we would come together. He always would bring balloons and just so many different things that he would do. And so we're going to miss him. I love him dearly. I'll reflect on the great memories of what he has left with us, along with my father. But he is with Jesus, and that is our ultimate goal.
God bless you and thank you. My oldest son wants to have words.
Well, we all love Uncle Mel to me very dearly. But one of the main things that I really liked about him, for all the Michigan haters out there, is that he was a Spartan fan. And so I remember one time, it was Christmas, and he was like Santa Claus. So it was a present, and he said, "To Mel, from Mel." We were all thinking like, what is he doing? And this was 2014, and he opened it, and he pulled out a green turtleneck. And then he pulled out a Michigan State sweatshirt. And then he pulled out a 2014 Rose Bowl ticket. And he was like, "I'm going to the Rose Bowl." And I think he left the day after. And he was just not telling us, so. Yeah, and then another time was, I was just getting out of practice because I played young Simba in The Lion King. And when I was coming out, I saw him in the front seat, bundled up with his Michigan State scarf and his hat. And then my brother and my dad were in the back, and I was like, "What's going on?" And they were like, "We're going to a Michigan State game." We looked back, and he said, "Oh, yeah." And this is the game that they played Penn State for, to go to the Big Ten Championship. But I actually think the picture was in the funeral booklet. Yeah. And so, yeah, that was one of the main things that I really liked about Uncle Mel. And we'll miss him dearly.
Beautiful tribute from siblings and nephews and nieces. Isn't it a wonderful thing to be able to hear the joy and the laughter? Can you remember Elder Mel saying, "What's up?" Look at somebody and say, "What's up?" And Vonda, you got me when he said, "Okay." Make things happen. He was known as an MC and as an orator. He was known for his eloquence and his ability to speak and his ability to motivate rooms and motivate crowds. He's still motivating us today. He's motivating us today, and he showed us what it means to serve. What it means to serve. Our bishop is going to come in a short while. We want you to just hang in there. But the choir is going to come. They're going to render a selection. Immediately following the choir selection, we're going to have the obituary. I'm sorry, we're going to do that differently. We're going to have the acknowledgement of the cards and condolences, and then we'll have the choir selection. After the choir selection, we want to stand and honor the man of God who is the prelate of the third ecclesiastical jurisdiction. He was the appointee, the man of God, who the Lord chose to succeed the late Bishop Marvin C. Pryor. Bishop Duncan is the pastor of the Lansing Church of God in Christ, but he's also our bishop and a great man of God in whom we have great respect. It's all right to clap your hands at this point. Great respect. Now, I watched the dynamic between he and Mel when Bishop Pryor passed on and Bishop Duncan became the bishop of our jurisdiction. He did not remove Mel from the position that he was in. In fact, he says, "Mel is doing an excellent job. Let's continue to keep things moving the way that they are." And we saw that the symbiotic relationship was very, very smooth, and there were other assistants that came to help. But we want to just take the moment to say thank you so much, Bishop Duncan, for allowing Elder Mel to continue to serve the jurisdiction that he loved. Southwest 3, are you in this room today? Southwest 3, I know you're in this room. Let's stand and salute that man of God and what Bishop did to keep Mel before us as our jurisdictional secretary. Thank you for doing that, Bishop. I'll come back with a more proper introduction before he gets up to speak, but Sister Barb Sain is going to come with acknowledgments and condolences. She won't get to read them all, so please don't be offended in any way. We're expediting time. We'll acknowledge you. The family will acknowledge you at a later time, and then our choir is going to come, and we'll move further in the service. Let's say amen.
Victorious Believers Ministries, we thank you for your prayers, cards, and condolences during this time of bereavement. We greatly appreciate your presence as we celebrate the life of our beloved son, brother, uncle, and cousin. A special thank you to Drs. Walter Rathkamp Sanha Ramasamy, Anderson Eye Associates, Yusha K. Belusi, Eye Care Specialist, Maury Sayoko, and Philip Liu, Kellogg Eye Center, and Dr. Stephen A. Telian, Ear, Nose, and Throat of University of Michigan. A more personal acknowledgement will be made at a later date. We have numerous condolences, so many of them, but I have been asked by the family to just acknowledge, and I'm just gonna read a few. I'm gonna acknowledge the ones that we have and just read a few. Bethel AME Church officers and members, Reverend P. David Saunders, Senior Pastor, Bethlehem Baptist Church, Pastor Lafayette Simpson, Center of Attraction Outreach, Pastors James and Leona Glenn, Christ Kingdom Ministries, Apostle Edward and Maddie Jackson, Senior Pastor and Founder, Daniel's Den Ministries Church Family, Pastor Taurus and Darlene Simpson, Empowered Believers Church, Pastor Johnny Brown III, First Church of Deliverance Elders and Christian Board and Members, Elder William E. Cook, Senior Pastor, Elder Jeanette Cook, Pastor, House of Prayer Outreach Church of God in Christ, Pastor Willie Loggins and First Lady Angie Loggins, Kingdom Life Ministries International, Apostle Albernus and Chantel Johnson, Pastor, Life and Church Ministries, Pastor Dennis Cotton, Sr., Loomis, Jesse Loomis Academy Parent Group, Freddie Marshall, President, Mrs. Cynthia Townsend, Principal, Michigan North Central Ecclesiastic Jurisdiction Church of God in Christ, Mother Corrine Wade Adams, Jurisdictional Supervisor, Michigan Southwest 5th Jurisdiction, Bishop Don W. Shelby, Jr., Jurisdictional Prelate, New Jerusalem Church in Lansing, Pastor Charles and Fran Vicey, New Jerusalem Full Gospel Church Membership, and also the Music Department, Elder Patrick Sanders Pastor, National Publishing Board Member, Deacon Stephen Savage, Bishop E. Blake Sr., Charles Blake Sr., International Presiding Bishop, New Covenant Christian Center, Drs. Ron and Georgia Frierson, Pentecostal Tabernacle Church of God in Christ, Elder Hemi Jamerson, Senior Pastor, Renaissance Church of God in Christ in Grand Rapids, Dr. Dennis J. McMurray, Senior Pastor, and Dr. Jean McMurray, First Lady, Solid Foundation Church of God in Christ, First Administration Assistant, Superintendent Edward J. Sewell, Pastor, and Missionary Gail Seward is First Lady, St. Luke Temple Church of God in Christ, Pastor Absalon Smith, Sr., Word of Faith International Ministries, Dr. Byron and Mrs. Chesame Hayes, Pastors, World Campus Outreach Church, Pastor Hurley J. Coleman and Lady Sandra Coleman, Olivet Institutional Baptist Church Family, the Reverend Dr. Jawanza Kareem Coleman, Pastor, Cathedral Faith Ministries Church of God in Christ, Administrator's Assistant, Chris E. Martin, Pastor, Greater Holy Temple Church of God in Christ, Bishop Roger L. Jones, Pastor, Gonzales Missionary Church of God in Christ, Pastor Burrell L. Nelson, International Adani Ministry Church of God in Christ, Pastor Donald R. Stevens, Prayer Room Ministries, Reverend Roy W. Bishop, Jr., Pastor, Refreshing Life Ministers, Superintendent Edward Jones, Pastor, Michigan Southeast Jurisdiction, the official cabinet of Bishop Roger L. Jones, Sr., Faith Temple, Pastor Eric Lewis, the Church of God in Christ Ministerial Alliance, President Pastor James Snead, Community Temple Church of God in Christ, Elder Sylvester Hill, Pastor, Michigan Southwest First Jurisdiction, Mother Regina Edwards, Supervisor, Living Waters Ministries Church of God in Christ, Elder Tommy Greer, Pastor, New Testament Church of God in Christ, Pastor Brian Keith Edwards, Tabernacle of David in Lansing, Pastor Larry Trice, Jr., Glimpse of Hope Ministry, Minister Leslie Lewis, Pastor, Greater Mount Zion Church, Elder Roland Hendricks, Senior Pastor, Oasis of Love, Elder Walter T. Pryor, Pastor, New Galilee Baptist Church, Pastor Lucius Lewis, Christ Deliverance Center, Pastor Bernia Nichols, Southside Church, Pastor Reverend Dr. Jeffrey A. Lane, Sr., Grace for the Nation, Pastor Terrence E. Lachey, Pastor. We have numerous cards, there's so many cards. I'm just gonna read these few resolutions.
No, this, I'm just going to acknowledge this one. United Sisters in Christ, Ethel Shaw, President. Word of Life Christian Center Church, Pastor Wayne and Beverly White, a pastor that's in Jackson, Michigan. The Bishop Wives Circle, Church of God in Christ Incorporated, Mother Willie Mae Sheard, President. Whereas we, the officers and members of the Bishop Wives Circle of the Church of God in Christ, feel it is befitting to express our sympathy to the family during the passing of Elder Mel A. Pryor. We commend you to him who knoweth all things. And whereas he served in the as the jurisdictional secretary of the Third Ecclesiastical Jurisdiction Southwest Michigan, and whereas Elder Mel was part of a loving and caring family who accepts the will of a sovereign God in the passing of their loved one. Therefore, be it resolved that we bow in humble submission to him who never makes a mistake and extend words of encouragement to the family in their time of sorrow. As 1 Corinthians chapter 13 explains, love never fails. You are in our sincere prayers. Again, that's the Bishop Wives. Mount Airy Church of God in Christ, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. And this is the church where Elder Mel was a part of this membership before he came to Victorious Believers Ministries. There are no words to express the sadness of those who knew Mel at Mount Airy Church of God feel at his passing. We remember his love for us as he taught Sunday school, was a member of the steering committee, and of course his outstanding articles as a writer for the Mount Airy Times. We know that God does answer prayers, and it is hard for us to understand his answer to this prayer, but he is too wise to make a mistake. We offer our sincere condolence and deepest sympathy in your loss of Elder Mel. May the outpouring of sympathy, the kind acts of friends and strangers, and the comfort in knowing that Jesus left the Comforter to comfort us at a time like this be with you. We ask for God's blessing on you and your family. Pastor Ernest C. Morris, the founder, J. Lewis Felton, servant leader, Mount Airy Church of God in Christ. Evangelistic Center, in loving memory of Elder Mel A. Pryor, the Evangelistic Center Church family rejoices at the life testimony of Elder Mel A. Pryor. His life was no ordinary one, for it was a life full of commitment to the work of the Lord. Today, we share the burden of your sorrow, and our heartfelt prayers extended to you, Evangelist Ruth Pryor, siblings and family of Elder Mel A. Pryor. Elder Mel was a great man of stature who openly loved living life to the fullest. His warm smile and loving embrace exemplified the love of Christ. Today his labor is done. We are confident that he is resting safely in the arms of our Lord and awaiting that great day when we shall meet at the banqueting table and together with the saints sing hymns and songs to glorify our Savior, Maker, Lord, and family. During this time of loss, may God's promise of eternal life bring you hope. May his ever-present love bring you peace. Bishop Jack C. Bond in Evangelistic Center International Ministries, Church of God in Christ. Glad tidings, Church of God in Christ, Hayward, California. To the beloved family, the Pryor family, and loving memory of Elder Mel A. Pryor, our deepest condolences are with your family during this your time of bereavement. We are praying that the abiding love of God will guide and sustain you now and days ahead. May you, in the midst of your sorrow, be filled with faith and peace that surpasses all understanding. Elder Mel has transitioned from labor to reward and is now resting in the presence of the Almighty God. This is from Bishop J.W. Macklin, Senior Pastor, and First Lady Vanessa J. Macklin. Wisconsin First Jurisdiction Church of God in Christ, Milwaukee, Wisconsin. We embrace you in prayer and love in the loss of your loved one, Elder Melvin A. Pryor. There remaineth therefore a rest to the people of God, for he that has entered into his rest, he also hath ceased from his own works as God did from his, Hebrews 4:19-10. Whereas removed from the midst of a long time labor in God's vineyard, Elder Mel Pryor, Bishop Sedgwick Daniels, and the constituents of the Wisconsin First Jurisdiction of the Church of God in Christ unite in fervent prayer as we mourn the passing of your loved one. This again is from Wisconsin First Jurisdiction, Pastor James Daniel III, Jurisdictional Secretary, Bishop Sedgwick Daniels, Jurisdictional Prelate, and J.
General Member Board. Lansing Church of God in Christ, resolution to the family of Elder Mel A. Pryor. Whereas Elder Mel A. Pryor served as the Southwest Michigan Third Ecclesiastical Jurisdiction Secretary and formerly served as a charter member of the Executive Board of the Men's Department and a Dean of the Scholastic Motivation Ministries and other capacities within the National Church. He was a fourth generation Cogent son, born to Evangelist Ruth C. Pryor and the late Marvin C. Pryor. Whereas Elder Mel A. Pryor attributed his commitment, excellence, and serving in what capacity he was found to his parents, Evangelist Ruth C. Pryor and the late Marvin C. Pryor. They taught him that education plus salvation equals success. Should be salvation plus education equals success. Truly his life bore witness to Proverbs 22:6, train up a child in the way that he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. The legacy of his father, the late Bishop Marvin C. Pryor, imparted into Elder Mel A. Pryor, manifested in the life of the beloved Elder Mel A. Pryor, as well as the unwavering support and guidance he continued to receive from his mother, Evangelist Ruth C. Pryor, which provided him strength to uphold his standard of life they established for him. Elder Mel A. Pryor acknowledged that any gift he possessed was a gift given, that he did not regard it as little. His heart was to be used only for God's glory and man's edification. 1 Corinthians 12:27 and 28. Therefore, be resolved that Pastor Bishop Samuel Duncan Jr. and elect Lady Dorothy Duncan, as well as the members of Lansing Church of God in Christ, express to the bereaved family our most heartfelt and sincere condolence in this hour. We are praying that God strengthen each of you. Be it resolved that the members of Lansing Cogent, Lansing Church of God in Christ, will let the memory of Elder Mel A. Pryor's service serve to live within each of us as we let our memories of him thrive. Again, this is from Lansing Church of God in Christ, as well as Southwest Street, where Bishop Samuel Duncan Jr. is our prelate. Victorious Believers Ministries, Church of God in Christ, to the bereaved family of Elder Melvin A. Pryor, when I've gone the last mile of the way, I will rest at the close of the day. And I know that there are joys that await me when I've gone the last mile of the way. Look to the hills from whence cometh your help. Where is the Almighty God in his infinite wisdom and limitless love has elected to escort from our midst Elder Melvin A. Pryor. We bow in humble submission to the will of God, the Board of Directors, and members of Victorious Believers Ministry, Church of God in Christ, extend to Pastor Chris and Lady Kenyatta and Mother Ruth C. Pryor, Derek Pryor, Vonda and John Massey, Alexis and Lauren Pryor, Carrington Drew and Chandler Blake Pryor, and the bereaved family, our sincere condolences and heartfelt sympathy in the loss of your dear loved one. No one can prepare for loss. It comes like a swift wind. May you find consolation in knowing that weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. Psalms 30:5, King James Version. Elder Mel loved the Lord, his family, the BBM church family, and the saints of God. This condolent message will remind you that although death separates us from one another in body, in spirit, the person always remains alive, alive through the words they said to us, the care and deeds they did for us, the lessons they taught us, and the example they were to us. His radiant smile, extended hand, warm embrace, and encouraging words exemplified the love of Christ. We will forever cherish the fond memories of Elder Mel, our chief administrator, a faithful supporter of the ministry, and one who helped to build kingdom leaders. His legacy of excellence will live on as we continue to make things happen. Be strong and of good courage. The Nation of Victorious Believers Ministries, Church of God in Christ, is praying that the Lord will give you strength and sustain you in your hour of bereavement. May you be comforted by the outpouring of love surrounding you. We pray for peace to bring comfort, courage to face the days ahead, and loving memories to hold in your hearts. Prayerfully submitted, Board of Directors, Evangelist Barbara Littles, Chairwoman, and the Nation of Victorious Believers Ministries Church family. The obituary.
Elder Mel A. Pryor entered this world in humble surroundings on March 3rd, 1966, and transitioned into his heavenly rest on Friday, April 7th, 2017, at the precious age of 51. He was a fourth generation Church of God in Christ's son, born into the loving family of Evangelist Ruth C. Pryor and the late Bishop Marvin C. Pryor. Elder Mel gratefully attributed his personal success to the exemplary life and love of his parents for nurturing, disciplining, and providing him with a strong spiritual heritage, educational foundation, and work ethic to serve the body of Christ and beyond. From the tender days of his youth, Elder Mel's parents taught him that salvation plus education equals success. As a result, he credited the church for providing the early training ground to his accomplished professional career. Elder Mel was a proud graduate of Michigan State University, a Laurel Spartan, earning a Bachelor of Arts in Business Administration, and then going on to acquire a Master of Business Administration in Marketing from Saginaw Valley State University. Prior to beginning his career in the ministry, he was employed by General Motors Corporation as a marketing and sales manager in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, overseeing staff in Greater Philadelphia, South New Jersey, and Northern Delaware. Elder Mel served as the chief administrator for Victorious Believers Ministries from 1994 until his heavenly transition, and as the chairman of the board of directors from 2011 to 2015. Elder Mel was an extraordinary and meticulous administrator who had a gift for writing, organizing, and managing the business of the church with superior quality and excellence. He made invaluable contributions to many facets of the ministry, including developing and directing the men's department for 16 years. Since 1996, he also served as a jurisdictional secretary of the Third Ecclesiastical Jurisdiction, Southwest Michigan. Within the National Church, Elder Mel formerly served as a charter member of the Executive Board of the Men's Department, Dean of Scholastic Motivation Ministries, a member of the Church Growth and Leadership Team, along with his father, the late Bishop Marvin C. Pryor, and within several other capacities. Elder Mel was a true servant leader who recognized that his unique aptitude for administration was a gift from God to be used for God's glory and man's edification. Elder Mel was a passionate and avid traveler who loved excitement, thrill and adventure. He also possessed a genuine compassion for those in need and was and management and Northwood University Business Division, and served as a consultant to the county government, several nonprofit agencies, and many churches and nonprofit board members. One of Elder Mel's favorite scripture was, "I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me," Philippians 4 and 13, King James Version. Elder Mel will forever be fondly remembered, and some of his favorite signature phrases included, "Make things happen, okay," and "Powerful, fresh, and anointed." He leaves to treasure his memory his loving mother, Evangelist Ruth C. Pryor, brothers Derek D. and Christopher B., Lady Kenyatta Pryor, sister Vonda K. and John Massey of New Jersey, grandmother Irma M. Trice, Jackson, Michigan, nieces Alexis C. and Lauren A. Pryor, nephews Carrington Drew and Chandler Blake Pryor, aunts Diane and Lewis Marshall of Atlanta, Georgia, Carol Jean Pryor of Houston, Texas, Lee Ethel Ellis, Michigan City, Indiana, Linda Pryor, Flint, Michigan, Pastor Angeline Trice, Lansing, Michigan, uncles Pastor Walter and Jackie Pryor of Jackson, Michigan, Deacon Willis Pryor, Jackson, Michigan, David Pryor, also of Jackson, and a host of cousins and loved ones who were deeply cherished. Godmother Mamie Coleman of Flint, Michigan, godchildren Desmond Bibbs, Saginaw, and Danae Shepherd, also Saginaw. He was preceded in death by his father, Bishop Marvin C. Pryor, and Flora B. Pryor, his grandmother.
Grace and Peace 2017.
Let us stand and salute the life of Elder Mel A. Pryor. Let it be resolved that this man of God has made a major impact in our lives. To conclude our service, we are going to have the climax of the moment, and that is to hear the word of the Lord from our bishop, the Bishop Samuel Duncan Jr. of the Lansing Church of God in Christ and the Third Ecclesiastical Jurisdiction. Bishop Duncan was appointed immediately after the passing of the late Bishop Marvin C. Pryor. He's worked tremendously in the community and is now developing a reputation internationally for his love, for his commitment, and his support to not only the church, but to many people that are in need. He's married to the evangelist Dorothy Duncan, and he's the father of two children and multiple grandchildren, and we thank God for his leadership. Mel honored and respected this man of God, and he honors and respects the leadership that we have seen in Bishop Duncan. After the choir has made their selection, the next voice that you will hear will be the voice of Bishop Samuel L. Duncan. Let's clap our hands, give God praise. Come on, look at somebody and say, bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Come on, clap those hands, give him praise.
I'm Father God of heaven, we come to you once again during this service with praise and with thanksgiving. We thank you for the life and the legacy of this young man that have touched so many lives of others, that have set a standard for those that follow. We thank you even now for his entire family, oh God, that has been touched by his existence. We thank you for all these that have come from near and afar. Our desire today is that you would touch this family like no one else or anything else can. In times like these, when the words of men seem so insignificant, you can speak with a small, still voice and give them the comfort and the consolation that they need. We know, oh God, that you understand our frailty and our limitations as human beings. You know just how much we can take and how much we can stand. We know that because you're righteous, you're too good to do wrong and certainly too wise to make a mistake. So we commend this family into your hand for your loving and your gracious keeping. We pray that what you've done so for so many others, that you would do for them even now. And even now, as I decrease, that you might increase, hide me behind the cross. Let no flesh be glorified. Under the unction and the power of your Holy Spirit, send forth a word of comfort, a word of strength, and a word of encouragement. And when all is said and done, we'll continue to rejoice and to celebrate the life and the legacy of this wonderful young man, Elder Mel A. Pryor. These blessings and others we do ask in Christ's name. Amen, amen, amen. Why don't you put those hands together one more time as you take your seat in the presence of the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Well, we certainly do give honor unto God who is the head of our lives. Amen. And to, amen, this wonderful family, prior family that I've known for many, many, many years. Amen. Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. I can go way, way back to Grant Street and Williams Memorial and so many other events and so many activities. Panama Beach, praise the name of the Lord. On the beach, praise God. But just a wonderful, wonderful family. And I feel so honored to be standing here today, but also to, amen, deem myself to be an adopted son, amen, brother, amen, friend into this wonderful, wonderful family. You have such a wonderful legacy, and Elder Mel A. Pryor, who did, amen, such a wonderful job at whatever he did, amen. The adjectives that you have in the bulletin are so befitting, amen, of Elder Mel, amen. It talks about how exceptional he was, how exemplary he was, and how exquisite he was, amen. Mel was quite the dresser. Amen. Mel would, he would break out with some stuff. He'd be sharp too. You know? Praise the name of the Lord. And he wore stuff I think only he could get by with. Amen. But he was always clean, always sharp, impeccable. Amen. From the crown of his head to the very sole of his feet. Amen. He's really already been eulogized by, amen, all the wonderful, amen, tributes that have been given to him from people from near and afar. Yeah. General board members that have come, amen, to have 45 seconds of words almost to let you know how much he loves you, how much he appreciated, man. We have our international missions president. We have Bishop Marvin Winans with us and a whole host of witnesses, amen, there. Praise God. And we have our lusted supervisor all these supervisors of Michigan, amen, praise God, my own lovely companion, to all these missionaries, these mothers, amen, to all of God's people, amen. What a wonderful gathering you would have, amen, thought maybe this was a bishop that had passed because of the turnout and the outcome, amen. Praise the name of the Lord. You can celebrate with me. That's a testament in itself, amen, to those who came, the number that came to, amen, stand with you in this difficult time. I appreciate Mel, amen, praise God. I heard a lot about him and the wonderful things he did as an administrator, but Mel was also a dynamic preacher, amen. His father put him up in one meeting, and I mean, he preached and he preached and he preached, amen. And I don't mean in a long way, I mean in a dynamic way under the anointing, because he had gotten so lost as a jurisdictional secretary, as an administrator, people never really recognized he also had another gift as a preacher, amen. And I thank the Lord for him, amen, because when I first became bishop, I didn't know anything about being bishop. And he was with me lock and step all the way to guide me through, amen, what it is, what it takes, what the responsibilities, what the requirements are. I remember the first women's convention after I became bishop. His mother, I think my wife and some others, we were in a plaza, a little shopping area. And they went in their direction, and he and I sat out in a court at a picnic table, and we talked, amen. And he really, really blessed my soul. Wow. He encouraged me, amen, because he could have said, "Bishop, I'm moving on. My dad's gone. I'm going to give it up and go in another direction." But he stood with me. Hallelujah. Praise God. I'll never forget that. Always be thankful for that. Amen. And he was always, amen, a man of excellence. Made me look good. Even in this instance, he would have been the one that wrote the resolution and the obituary. I mean, the condolence. So he's going to be sorely missed. And we don't even know the magnitude of that until we begin to move forward. Man's greatness and his worth is always manifested after he is gone. But again, there's no doubt that Mel touched so many lives, and a man of distinction, amen, and again, just a man of excellence. And we thank God for the 51 years, which seemed so short, but yet he did so much. So I endeavor not to be before you very long on this afternoon, amen. Again, the family could have picked so many other people to do this, and I'm just thankful to be a part. And as I prayed and I sought the Lord, amen, as to what can I say? What can be said that will comfort this family? And I believe the Lord put this scripture in my heart and in my spirit. Because again, when it comes to times like these, we can say words, amen, and try to give words of comfort, but it's only the word of God that can strengthen, that can heal, and that can deliver in a time like this. So he put in my spirit Revelations 14 and 13. And in the King James Version, it reads as follows. And I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, write, blessed are the dead which die in the Lord from henceforth. Yea, saith the Spirit, that they may rest from their labors, and their works do follow them. The Living Bible says, and I heard a voice in heaven above saying, write this down. At last the time has come for his martyrs to enter into their full reward. Yes, says the Spirit, they are blessed indeed, for now they shall rest from all their toils and trials, for their good deeds do follow them to heaven. And finally, from the Message Bible, I heard a voice out of heaven write this: blessed are those who die in the Master from now on. How blessed to die that way. Yes, says the Spirit, and blessed rest from their hard work. None of what they've done is wasted. God blesses them for it all in the end. Hallelujah. Blessed, hallelujah, are the dead which die in the Lord. The life beyond. The operative phrase is which die in the Lord. People are dying all the time, but everyone, when they die, is not in the Lord. Yea, saith the Spirit, that they may rest from their labors, and their works do follow them. Mel was a laborer. He was a hard worker. In spite of his challenges, amen, I never ever heard Mel complain one time. I never, amen, saw him come up short or neglect his responsibilities. The Bible teaches that life does not end at the grave. The eternal spirit and image of God within us cannot be destroyed by the death of the body. John must have had this truth in mind when he wrote Revelations 14 and 13. When you look at it, death is brief and temporary. Our intelligence and our spiritual parts are essentially imperishable. Death does not destroy the inhabitant of a house. It only takes down the house in which he lives. The faithful believer never dies. The Bible says that whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. The Bible says, for we know that if our earthly house of this tabernacle be dissolved, we have a building of God and house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. I think sometimes we forget that we're just pilgrims and travelers passing through this old earth. That this is not our permanent destination or our permanent home. That we're just passing through this old earth. The Bible also says, for we that are in this tabernacle do groan, being burdened. Not that we would be unclothed, but clothed upon, that mortality might be swallowed up in life. Now he that hath wrought us for the selfsame thing is God, who also hath given unto us the earnest of the Spirit. Therefore we are always confident, knowing that while we are home in the body, we're absent from the Lord. While we're in this body, we may be in his presence, but we are not with his presence. Hallelujah. Believest thou this? The grave is only an end. Man was created immortal, and he shall rise from the grave and live forever. Death shall be destroyed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption. And this mortal must put on immortality. Praise the name of the Lord. Death is our entrance into heaven. Praise his holy name. It is the soul's liberation from all bondage and limitation that mar us and limit our expansion. Hallelujah. The Bible says there shall be no more death. Here we are in the world of the dying. Our loved ones are snatched away. And in regards to our own life, we don't know what the day may bring. In the future state of the believer, there shall be no more death. The everlasting life given to believers through Christ cannot be broken by any power. The river and the tree of life will afford a never-ending existence. Obviously, this is a view, amen, of death from the other side. Viewed from our vantage point, death appears to be dreadful, defeating, and devastating. But from God's vantage point, it's altogether different. He calls the dead blessed. That word literally means happy, to be congratulated, to be fortunate. Hallelujah. Far from being pitied, God tells us that those who die with faith in the Lord ought to be envied. Hallelujah. Male's in a better place. He's in a place where there is no more dying. A place where there's no more suffering. A place where there's no more crying and no more pain and no more body affliction. Oh, hallelujah. Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. Hallelujah. For we walk by faith and not by sight. We are confident, I say, and willing rather to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord. A lot of times folks say they don't act like they don't know where somebody's at. Maybe if they die outside of God, you may not know where they are. But I think deep down inside you really do, because there's really only two destinations. Hallelujah. Either you're going up or down. Blessed is the dead who die in the Lord. And to be absent from the body means to be present, hallelujah, with the Lord. Death is the doorway to rest from our labors. How many of you have ever said, I'm so tired, I wish I could just get some rest, amen, and you lay down, you don't even sleep good at night, and you get up and you start all over. But when we leave this place, and when we enter into the presence of the Lord, we'll find a rest like none other. A rest that we can't find any other place. Hallelujah. The word labor describes a wearing out from work, a worrisome toil. I don't know about you, but it seems like I've been working all my life. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. And when it looked like I was going to retire, have some fun in the sun, fish a little bit, play a little more golf, God said, I got another assignment for you. Hallelujah. It suggests to us that life is often hard. It can be full of difficulties, disappointment, and disease. God promises rest from all of that. There comes a time when we need to lay down our burdens and to be at rest. The word rest appears here in a beautiful way. It means to be at ease, to be refreshed. It suggests an end to the toils and the tribulations of life. That is what Jesus promised when he said, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. We keep looking for God to give us stuff, but what we really need is some rest. Hallelujah. In this world of trouble, we can know rest. But there's a greater and a more complete rest for us when we go to be with the Lord. It is the rest of heaven and the presence of God. And those who have laid their burdens down and entered into it, praise God, are congratulated because they are fortunate. Hallelujah. I think even Brother John Massey sings a song, he will welcome you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. We act like heaven is some foreign place, but it's our destiny. John in Revelation says their works do follow them. We are all making a record on earth. We carry the record of our life with us into eternity. But the lives that we live, by the words that we say and the deeds that we do, we are laying up for ourselves treasures in heaven. Jesus said, if we give a cup of water to a little child, because we are his disciples, we will in no way lose our reward. The Bible tells us that God will not forget our work and our labor of love, which we have done in his name as ministers to others. Our works will follow us. They accompany us to the very judgment of God. The purpose of the judgment is not to determine our destiny, but to determine our reward in that destiny. We are saved by grace, but we will be rewarded by our works if we have lived faithfully and served the Lord lovingly. Then death becomes our doorway from a place of trouble to a place of rest. Hallelujah. Those which die in the Lord, the blessedness announced is the result of character and conduct. And if anybody had character and conduct, it was Mel A. Pryor. He had great character. He conducted himself like a saint ought to. He conducted himself like a man ought to. He watched after his mother. He saw to her well-being. He saw to her safety. He saw to her happiness. Thank be to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. They who cannot think cheerfully of death have probably never thought cheerfully and rationally about life. Hallelujah. We used to sing that when this life is over, I'll fly away. One glad morning. When this life is over, hey, hallelujah, I'm not going to always be here. You won't always be here, but it's going to be a great day. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. The weariness of physical labor, the depressing reactions of intellectual pursuits, and the strain of spiritual conflict are all things of the past. Hallelujah. Their works do follow them, while the price of their purchase into heaven, hallelujah, is a high price. But oh, when I get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. I can see Mel now saying I made it. Hallelujah. Through the toils, through the snares, through the pain, through the disappointment, I made it. I fought a good fight. And no matter what came my way, I kept the faith. I didn't let my physical challenges stop me from staying in the race. I ran with all I had. I persevered with all I knew. I made it. Said the Lord, man is in a better place. Now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, neither do corruption inherit incorruption. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall rise incorruptible, and we shall one is corruptible, must put on incorruption. This mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruption shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up. Death is swallowed up in victory. Oh, death, where's thy sting? Oh, grave, where's thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be unto God, who gives me the victory. Man has the victory. Man, he made it. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Family, be encouraged. Hold on to God's unchanging hand. Cry if you gotta cry. Mourn if you gotta mourn. Feel down at times. But the Lord said, in spite of all this, let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. For in my Father's house are many mansions. And if it were not so, I would have told you. And I go. To prepare a place for you. And if I go and I prepare that place, guess what? I'm coming again. Hallelujah. The other day, God came to L.A. Pride. He had been through a lot. He endured much. But God said it's time to come on home, to take your mansion in the sky, the life that is beyond. God has a place for you, for me, and everybody that dies in him. Hallelujah. Death is not the end. Grave is not the finale. Hallelujah. The grave holds the old body, but the spirit goes to God. But God said through Paul, brethren, I would not have you be ignorant, for the time is going to come that the angels is going to sound the trumpet. Hallelujah. And he's not going to send Michael. He's not going to send Gabriel. But he's going to come himself. For the Lord shall descend from heaven with the shout of the voice of the archangel. And then it's going to be on. For he said, don't think that those that are living are going to proceed. Those that are dead, for the dead in Christ are going to rise first. And then we that yet remain are going to be caught for meat in the air. I don't know about you, but I got some loved ones that I'm looking to see again. I got a father up in heaven. Up in heaven. Hallelujah. I'm waiting. For that great getting up morning. Revelation says, and I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God. And the books were open, and another book was open, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books according to their works. And the sea gave up the dead which were in it. And death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them. And they were judged, every man, according to his works. And death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. Hallelujah. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast. I think we can truthfully and honestly say that we believe that Mel's name was written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Hallelujah. He worked, he served, he sacrificed, he gave. Hallelujah. And he kept. He left a wonderful legacy, even down to his nieces and nephews, who have very fond memories of their uncle. As it was stated earlier, that's something you can never, ever take away. The memories, the fond times that you had with Mel. Hallelujah. God is a healer. Lady Pryor, I know it. This seems so rough and so tough. But God has you. God's got your back. God's going to sustain you. He's going to keep you. Derek, Pastor Chris, Kenyatta, hallelujah, Vonda, amen, Brother Massey, Mother Trice, amen. Praise God to the entire family. You have a very gifted and talented. Legacy just keeps growing and growing and growing. Like I said, I've been around y'all a long, long time. Back to Ella Nunn Walker. I got it, right? But you're talking about anointed. Preaching. Serving God. Until the day was done. Jackson lost greatly. But God hasn't brought you this far to leave you now. And he's not unjust to allow you to go through what you're going through right now needlessly. And even though you may not see the reason why now, in the by and after a while, God will reveal it to you. But I believe what was said earlier, right now, Mel's vision is 2020. His hearing and his audibility are at the right decimal levels where he can hear himself talk and he can hear what's being said to him. Hallelujah. Because when we rise, amen, those old bodies that are in the grave are not going to be, amen, the bodies that we resume. But we're going to take on new bodies, incorruptible bodies. And as I read that, amen, they alluded to even an awareness of one another. Because they said when Jesus got up and he came and went amongst his disciples, they recognized where he was. Hallelujah. Even though he had died and been resurrected, when they saw him, they knew who he was.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I can't say that emphatically. I'm just saying what the commentators say. But amen, if there's going to be rejoicing, hallelujah, on that great getting up morning, I think there's going to have to be some kind of cognizance for us to rejoice about and to rejoice over. Hallelujah. So again, I encourage you, amen, praise God. We're calling for the funeral director to come, amen, and we vow, amen, not to go away after this day is over, but to yet be there with you and for you. Amen. A lot of people go back to their respective places, but the Southwest 3 family, I and First Lady personally, we're going to be there. We're going to touch base with you. God's going to strengthen you, and God's going to heal. Amen. Praise God. Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. If you don't know Christ, today is the time to get to know him. Tomorrow is certainly not promised. Neither is today. Amen. We don't know what may take place in our lives before the end of the day. But the scripture lets us know that if you die in the Lord, you're indeed blessed. Hallelujah. Praise God. We don't want to be rid. Yes, I know this is a funeral, but what a wonderful tribute it would be of the mail for someone to give their life unto Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. So if everyone would just close their eyes and bow their heads right now before we pray. If you're here today and you don't know Christ, you can raise your hand right where you are. And there are multiple men and women that can minister to you in the Word of God about your soul. You don't have to be afraid. You don't have to be ashamed. Because the grace of God, the blood of God, will cover your sins and your past. Are you here today? Just raise your hand. Your life will never ever be the same. Hallelujah. When the Lord comes into your life, you can have peace in the midst of a storm. Hallelujah. When you're weak, he'll give you strength. Father God of heaven, we thank you and we praise you even right now in the name of Jesus. Again, we thank you for the life and the legacy of this wonderful young man that have touched so many lives throughout this country. We thank you, oh God, that he's in a better place, that no afflictions are impeding him right now. Hallelujah. We thank you for the family. Once again, strengthen, encourage them. All of us that have come from near and far. This comes as a reminder of how frail we are and how finite our lives really are. Job said they're like a vapor. They're here 1 minute and gone the next. So, Father God, we thank you and we praise you for your goodness and your mercy. And we know, oh God, that you are a God of mercy. Your word declares that you are the God of all comfort. So manifest your comfort. We're going to have a committal here at the church. Praise God. And then we will have our recessional. For as much as it has pleased Almighty God to take out of this world our deceased male Abraham, we commit his body to Mother Earth. Earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust, looking for the general resurrection in the last day, and the life of the world to come through our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose second coming in glorious majesty to judge the world, the earth and the sea shall give up their dead, and the corruptible bodies of those who sleep in him shall
shall be changed and made like unto his own glorious body, according to the workings whereby he is able to subdue all things unto himself. Hallelujah. I'm going to ask everyone to repeat after me. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from all evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for now and ever. Amen. I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, blessed are the dead who die in the Lord from henceforth. Yea, saith the Spirit, that they may rest from their labors, and their works do follow them. If you just bow your heads once again. Now may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, of the blood of the eternal Jesus, equip you to do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight. Through his son Jesus, to whom be glory forever and ever. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God our Father and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all to keep us and to sustain us, even now and forevermore. Amen. Amen. This time we're in the hands of the funeral director. Thank you.
Yeah.